Welcome, folks. It's nice to see some friendly faces out there, as well as some new faces. The purpose of this evening, as Carl was saying, is to give you an overview as to some of the changes that the new yellow book has come out. Have you all got your yellow books? These nice, pretty yellow things. You see, every time amendments happen to BS7671, people complaining about the fact that it's another £80, yet again another £80. Why do we bother with this book? Well, most of you are already aware, it's our get out of jail free card. It's a tool. So £80 for another tool in our toolkit, if we start thinking of it in that sort of scenario, then it's not a bad investment. Bearing in mind, this gives us the guidance that we need to comply with our main pieces of legislation. The problem is, the legislation that we have to comply with, the understanding and interpretation of that keeps changing. Electrical energy has been used commercially in the UK for, well, under 150 years. So we're still learning a lot as we go on. And this is what some of the changes have been about in this version. So tonight we're going to talk about some of the main changes and what sort of impact they're going to have within the works that you guys do. It's not intended to be an in-depth, it's intended to be a heads up. This is something you need to be aware of, this is something you need to consider. You've got various different handouts within your pack. One is a summary of the changes. You've also got a copy of the PowerPoint. Now, I will put my hands up now. I made a few typos. Between the one that you've got and the one that you'll see, we will be correcting that so that you guys will have the up-to-date information. So some of the key things that we need to think about with regards to this third amendment of BS7671 is, when does it come into force? So what are the key dates? Well, first of all, it was issued 1st of January 2015. Mind you, if you could buy it anywhere on the 1st of January 2015, you were one of the privileged few. However, as with any amendment that comes into BS7671, we normally get a grace period before it becomes what we term as enforceable. But of course, we know that BS7671 isn't actually an enforceable document. But we can use other versions of BS7671 up till the 1st of July. From then on, from the 1st of July onwards, everything that we do must be in accordance with the Yellow Book. So to break that down into realistic terms, between the 1st of January and the 30th of June, we can use the other amendments of BS7671. Now, as you know, this is Amendment 3. So Amendment 1 was the Green Book that everyone had a copy of. Then Amendment 2 didn't actually get printed as an update to the main document. It was an additional section, because Amendment 2 was with regards to electric vehicle charging, and that was all it was dealing with. So therefore, it was issued as a separate publication. So electrical installations between now and the 30th of June can be designed and installed to Amendment 1 or Amendment 2. Now, Amendment 2 only comes in if you're dealing with an installation that's got electric vehicle charging. But from the 1st of July this year, all installations must be designed in accordance with the Third Amendment. Now, note I said designed. The reason being is, in this 6 month cutover period, there will be some installations that will be designed using the First or Second Amendments. That means that we might be installing them to those versions, and we need to be aware of that. This might even mean that there's a cascade period of up to 2 years before you're starting to do installation work in accordance with the Third Amendment, depending on the design spec and the design scope. Because larger electrical installation work can take several years to complete the project. You agree? So we're getting some nods. Obviously, that's a good feel. You can not. Yeah, I forgot to check. Can everyone hear me? Yeah. Marvellous. Okay. So as of the 1st of July, all new installation work must be designed in accordance with the new book, with the Third Amendment. However, new installation work might still be being performed to the First and Second Amendments. The numbering system. You're thinking, oh no, I was just getting to grips with the numbers. Does that mean it's all changed again? A little bit. The 17th edition, as we now know, is based on the IEC, the International Electrotechnical Commission's numbering policy, that it's digits with dots, no zeros, no dashes. And we know the way in which the regulation number goes together is the first three digits tell us whereabouts in the book it is, and then the digits that come after that then tell us what section, what group, etc. That hasn't changed. That's a good thing. That hasn't changed. However, some of you will remember in the First Amendment they introduced the 100 series numbers. And the 100 series numbers related specifically to British legislation. That bit has changed. The 100 series numbers is now going to be reserved for Senelec harmonisation requirements. If you remember, a lot of our work was geared up with complying with the harmonised standard that Senelec had publicised. That is now going to be allocated as the 100 series numbers. And therefore, numbers that then just relate to British legislation will be 200 series numbers. So whereas the regulation number might have ended up in a 100 series, for example, when we put cables in walls, it was regulation 522.6.101. That will now change to 201. So it's just a case of changing it from a 100 series to a 200 series. And that covers a lot of changes that have occurred in this Third Amendment. It's gearing us up so when the 18th edition comes out, which will be in a couple of years' time, which already started work. I know, I can see the raised eyebrows. So again? Yeah, it's going to happen. Then the framework will already be in place and those 100 numbers can then be easily identified. So why are we doing all these changes? Well, with regards to this, with the change from the initial regulation numbers to the secondary regulation numbers, it's a transparent change. There are still some subtle word changes, but if it was originally identified specifically as a 100 series, it will still exist then as a 200 series. However, it might be simplified. Now, that's a good term, isn't it? Anyone that's read the regs a lot, simplified, that has to be good. Let's get away from some of the ambiguity. And that's another big change that has happened in this edition. They've simplified terms and clarified certain ambiguities that were in existence. However, we've also seen lots of changes elsewhere within our industry. Changes in British standards, changes in BSEN numbers, changes in IEC standards. And if we want BS7671 to be our get out of jail free card, then we need to adopt it or change it to take into account those changes. Some of the more significant changes include things like emergency lighting. How many of you, show of hands, get involved in emergency lighting systems? Well, since 2013, it's not just to BS5266, it's also to BSEN 1838. Now, straight away, that raises alarm bells. In emergency lighting, alarm bells. He's getting the two. No, perhaps not. It raises alarm bells. What is it that we're doing differently? To be honest with you, at the moment, BSEN 1838 is typically almost a carbon copy of what the old BS5266 was. However, they are forecasting changes within the next few years, and therefore we're already gearing up BS7671 to take that into account. If you've got the electrician's guide to emergency lighting systems, you already see it's already on the second edition to take into account some of those changes with regards to the BS number. And there are some subtle changes in it that we need to be aware of. Therefore, BS7671 is reflecting that to say, remember, when you're doing this sort of system, it's now this and this. So when you're going through the scoping part, you can see those changes come up. So talking about the scope, part one. As we know, BSM 671 is split into seven parts, with 16 appendices. This time that hasn't changed. There are still the seven parts and there are still the 16 appendices. So what are the changes to part one? Well, it says here, no major changes. However, if you read the scope of BS7671 on that first section, 110.1, it now lists, instead of 16 different types of installation, 26 different types of installation covered specifically by BS7671. Now you might immediately be thinking, hang on a minute, it says on the board there, no minor changes. Is this one of these typos you were talking about? Well, no. What they've actually done is they've identified a lot of the special installations and locations that were in part seven are now categorically mentioned in that scope. By mentioning them in that scope, it's drawing people's attention to, yeah, these are now covered and these are covered. With regards to part two, however, part two, as we know, clarifies the language that we use, the definitions. The definitions have changed, and they've changed quite significantly to try and make things a little bit easier for us to understand and interpret. However, there are some new ones that have been added. Typically, some of the favourites, auxiliary circuits and non-flame propagating. These are two new terms that have been introduced, terms that we've probably used for quite a while within the industry. But I just want to talk about them with a little bit more context when we come to talk about some of these later parts. We've got a section that deals now specifically with auxiliary circuits, so we'll understand what that means. But we've also got a specific regulation that talks about the use of non-flame propagating enclosures. And I'll talk about that because this is one of the significant changes that has come in with this third amendment. There are other terms that have changed. Competent person no longer exists in BS7671. Ah, there's some nice smiles there. That was always a hard one to get your head around. However, it hasn't changed in the electricity at work regulations. Regulation 16 is still persons need to be competent to be able to do their job. So why take it out of BS7671? Well, some of you, I've no doubt, have encountered the struggles and the strifes about, well, hang on a minute, does being defined as a competent person mean that I'm a member of a scheme? Or does it mean that I'm able to do the job? Or what does it mean? What makes me competent? So this has now been removed, the term competent person, but it has been replaced. Two of the terms that have been replaced, skilled person. They've added skilled person electrically within BS7671. And I just want to read to you what they actually define as a skilled person electrically. It says, person who possesses, as appropriate to the nature of the electrical work to be undertaken, adequate education, training and practical skills, and who is able to perceive risks and avoid hazards which electricity can create. Now, I've no doubt some of you that have had courses with me, and when I've said, so what makes a person competent? And we've gone through and everyone's saying, qualifications. And I said, no, that doesn't make a person competent. No, qualifications now makes you a skilled person electrically. Now, this is the first time that we've seen this requirement coming in, that we have to have adequate education. Now, does it mean formal qualifications, or does it mean I've had on-the-job training, or does it mean I must be apprenticeship served? Well, all of them. I need to have a suitable and adequate training appropriate for the work that I'm doing. So whether I've got that education from an apprenticeship, or whether I've got that education from going and doing an intensive training course, or whether I've got it because I've done evening classes, that's irrelevant. I've received the appropriate training. And this is what it's trying to get across. So now we've got a skilled person must have those significant qualifications. But it also said there, the practical skills and who is able to perceive risk and avoid hazards which electricity can create. Now you all know as well as I do, the changes that have been driven in health and safety legislation are the need to do risk assessments. You all know about having to do a risk assessment before you do work activities. Well, how are you going to demonstrate that you're a skilled person if you can't produce a risk assessment on the work activity that you're going to do? In doing that, though, you're also satisfying your requirements under the Construction Design and Management Regulations, the Health and Safety Management Health and Safety Regulations, all those other pieces of legislation that state you must produce a risk assessment. You're now able to identify it's also a requirement from BS7671. What about the next phrase, though? An instructed person. Well, this is clarified on page 30 of the new book. And it says, for an instructed person. It says, instructed person, electrically, a person adequately advised or supervised by a skilled person, as defined, to enable that person to perceive risk and avoid hazards which electricity can create. Therefore, an instructed person is anyone that you say, don't do that, you'll get hurt if you touch that. Is that a fair statement? If you, as the electrically skilled person, turn around and say, oh, you shouldn't do that, don't do, are they now an instructed person? Or do you think it goes a little bit further than that? Well, hopefully it goes a little bit further than that. But even if you were to take it to its literal meaning, yes, that could be an instructed person. This again ties into the requirements of the Electricity at Work Regulations, Regulation 16, about advising that people, if they are not competent to do the work safely, then they are under such a level of supervision as may be deemed appropriate. So if I don't want people touching it, and I've put up suitable warnings and I've told people don't touch it, it's fair to say then that they are instructed. If I've got an apprentice working for me, and I say, right, I want you to strip that and terminate that into that, and then I want you to put that up there and do that there, they are then instructed, are they not? But it's not enough just to say that. You've also got to explain to them the hazards and the risks that they might be subjected to in doing that work and make sure that they understand that part. So it then moves away from the using the apprentice, just do it, just do it. It now starts them having to understand what they're doing. That's got to be a good thing, isn't it? Rather than us getting to the point in the industry where, why do we always do it like this? Well, because we always do. Yeah, but why? How many times have you thought to yourself, but why are we doing it this way? Well, because I did it like that last time and the time before, and I've always, the on-site guide says I do it that way, but why? Why are we choosing these methods? Why are we doing, and this is the first step that the industry is trying to make in actually improving the quality of work and knowledge that we have out there. The word competent, though, hasn't it and totally disappeared, though. Competent person has, but because of Regulation 16 of the Electricity at Work Regulations, we can't just chuck it out. So how do we make sure? Well, we're now starting to say that, for example, anyone doing electrical inspection and testing, they must be electrically skilled in inspection and testing and competent to do so. So they're adding it into the requirement of the regulation to identify that, okay, yeah, you've got to be skilled to do it, but you also must be competent to do it. So that's then reinforcing the requirement from the Electricity at Work Regulations that says you must possess the knowledge, the skills, but more importantly, be able to identify when it's not safe to continue. And the way in which you can identify that is from doing things like risk assessments, method statements, common practice, standard practice throughout. Okay? There's also a new section. Within part two, we saw in the First Amendment, they added in that lovely bit on pages 38 and 39 that told you all the symbols that was used and where to find them and what they meant. They've now expanded that a little bit in that they've now put what we used to call in the industry FUAs, frequently used acronyms. So that's what they've done. A list of abbreviations now appears in the end of part two. And not only does it tell you what the abbreviation means, it also tells you where, again via regulation number or section number, it appears within the regs. So for example, CFL, compact fluorescent luminaires, CPC, circuit protective conductor, DNA, they're all ones that we recognise, or should recognise. But how many times have you heard people using a slight variation on what you think, hang on a minute, I always thought it meant this. Well, this will help get rid of that. Now we know what the acronym means, now we know it throughout. And therefore, even newbies into the industry will be talking a similar language to what we talk. Yeah, right. In theory, yeah? One of the other changes in trying to be make it more easy and comprehensive to understand is the term multiphase didn't really mean anything. So they changed it to the term polyphase. Now polyphase is a term that has been used now in educational circles for the last 10 to 15 years. It's just a posh way of saying two-phase or three-phase. Poly, of course, meaning many. So what they've tried to do is standardize the language throughout, because in some sections of the book they were talking about multi-phase systems, and in other sections of the book they were talking about polyphase systems. So they've adopted the one common terminology throughout, and polyphase is just one of the examples that they've started to do that with. There are other subtle differences throughout where they've used a mixture of terminology throughout, but they've tried to standardize it throughout now. For example, equipotential. We used to call a lot of components within the regs, we used to talk about equipotential this, equipotential that, and equipotential this. As we know, equipotential talks about making equal voltage, and we normally associate it with bonding. More commonly, supplementary bonding. It's about making sure that I join together all the metal parts, all the exposed metal parts and extraneous metal parts in an area, so that when I touch them, there's no difference in voltage between them, even under fault conditions. Well, that's not always the case, especially if I'm talking about electromagnetic interferences. I might have bonding conductors there that aren't necessarily there to provide equipotential zones. And under section 444, they actually removed the term equipotential from some of the descriptions, and now it's just called bonding conductors. So that's quite a key one that they've focused on. The term that they had used was that it was a bypass equipotential bonding conductor. It's not really. It's now just a bypass bonding conductor. It's just there to reinforce the bonding. It's not there to replace the equipotential bonding. And it was felt by calling it a bypass equipotential, it was another way of getting around the system, which of course we don't want. So part three, what are the requirements of part three? Well, again, there's very few changes. And similar to Amendment 1, Amendment 2, where they were putting in the changes, they always put the line beside the text that they're changing. And you might be a little bit worried when you start leaving through your yellow copy that you think, oh my goodness, there's lots of lines here. Most of the lines, though, are just about changing a standard number that it referenced, or changing a term from where it used to say competent person to now saying skilled electrically. But with regards to part three, there is a specific change with regards to regulation 332.1. I'm going to read that to you. For those of you that are worried about page numbers, I know how fond some people get of page numbers in the regs. 332 now appears on page 49, and it says, all electrical equipment forming part of an electrical installation shall meet the appropriate electromagnetic compatibility or EMC requirements and shall be in accordance with the relevant EMC standard. Okay, so that sounds pretty straightforward. What's the change? Well, it used to say all electrical installations. So that was the requirement that it identified. All electrical installations. Now it's actually clarifying, they're saying all the equipment that make up the installation. So under the requirements of equipment, we know then that that's now not cables. Do you agree? Yeah, some nods, good. It's now talking about the accessories and the appliances and the loads that we connect onto our installation, either as the fixed installation or as a temporary part of the installation. It's not necessarily the fixed wiring as such. But this is quite an important aspect in with regards to the change, because we ended up with people that were worried about electromagnetic compatibility going way over the top with regards to containment systems and things like that. Now we can actually appreciate it. It's about protecting the equipment from the electromagnetic interferences rather than just the wiring from the electromagnetic interferences. That's really the only change that's in part three. So far there's not much scary happening. Part one, it's just about clarifying some of the terms in the scope, changing some of the standard numbers. Part two is about introducing some of the other words that are being used and also giving us more reference information to find it easier to understand. And then part three is just really that one requirement. Where we see the major parts of our changes comes, of course, in part four. Yes. The first key one is this one, our old favourite. Regulation 411.3.3 is titled up as additional protection. That bit hasn't changed. And if you remember, it used to say that when you had a socket outlet rated at 20 amps or less, that was for use by ordinary persons, for general purpose that use, it had to be RCD protected. We always used to stick in a 30 milliamp RCD. Happy days. But then it had a couple of exclusions underneath that. It said, what if that socket outlet is in a location where the use of the socket outlet is supervised and the equipment that's used on it is supervised, and supervised by skilled or instructed persons? Then surely there's no need to do it. In fact, we used to use the example here. When we have our test boards, they're connected via plug and socket. It's no good them being RCD protected, because every time we did simulation of RCD testing, RCD would trip. So that wasn't adequate. But it was deemed that, well, hang on a minute, those socket outlets are only used for that dedicated piece of equipment, and they can only be energized when the instructor has allowed them to be energized. So it's under their full control, so they're perfectly supervised. Tick in the box. But how many times have we heard people say, that'll be supervised? And you then go into an office area that has apparently got supervised socket outlets, and everyone's plugging in their mobile phones or their digital radios from home or their phone chargers, yeah, or even their own iPads or tablets or laptops. Where's the supervision gone? Out the window. And those socket outlets are not RCD protected, and yet there's the risk then they're being used for general purpose, and there's no protection there. So they've changed this regulation. They said, socket outlets rated at 20 amps or less that are for use by ordinary persons should be RCD protected. The exclusion, however, well, I'm going to read the exclusion so we make sure that we get it word perfect. It says, I can just turn to the page. 411.3.3, and it says, additional protection. In AC systems, additional protection by means of an RCD, in accordance with regulation 415.1, shall be provided for socket outlets with a rated current not exceeding 20 amps. And it says, an exception to that point is permitted where, other than for an installation in a dwelling, a documented risk assessment determines that the RCD protection is not necessary. In other words, if your client is saying, oh yeah, it's going to be supervised, great, I'd like to see the risk assessment for that, please. The risk assessment must be documented. Oh yeah, yeah, I'll do one. I haven't done it yet. I'll do one for you. If you can just put the insulation, great, fine. What then makes them produce that risk assessment? Well, the nice thing is the electrical installation certificate has changed. On the electrical installation certificate, it now says, for regulation 411.3.3, is RCD protection provided for the socket outlets? Yes or no? No. Attach risk assessment. The certificate is not complete until the risk assessment is attached to it. Straight away, that gets away from the tomorrow talk. Yeah, I haven't done it yet. I've got to do it. Well, the certificate can't be issued without the risk assessment. And if you don't have the risk assessment, you've got to put RCD protection in. What's that other bit, though, that you said, James? Well, it said, where other than for an installation in a dwelling. That exclusion doesn't apply if it's a dwelling. If it's a dwelling, it doesn't care whether or not the owner of the house is, I work for HSC, I can do risk assessments all the time. No worries. No, that doesn't count. It's now a case of, it's a dwelling. Anyone can come in and plug something into that socket outlet. Therefore, it must be RCD protected. No questions, no ifs, no buts, no maybes. But what about the one that we used to have where it was just for a single dedicated piece of equipment? That was our other get out of jail card, wasn't it? Well, it goes on to say then, yes, that is permitted for a specific labelled or otherwise suitably identified socket outlet provided for connection of a particular item of equipment. So that one still exists. But do you think I can have that socket off a ring? No. It must be on its own dedicated circuit. Okay, so if it's going to be off its own dedicated circuit, what other things do I need to think about? Will it still have to worry about when cables are buried in walls? Remember, as soon as we start putting that cable in the wall, if we're not offering it mechanical protection, then it has to be RCD protected. Because building regulations state when we're chasing out load-bearing walls, we can't go deeper than a third of the wall when going vertically or a sixth of the wall when going horizontally. Now, my maths ain't that great, but if you think about it, a third is 33.3 millimetres and a sixth is 16.67 millimetres. They're going to be in that first 50 millimetres of the wall and therefore need RCD protection. So even if I do decide to put the freezer on its own dedicated socket, as soon as I start burying that cable in the wall, it's got to be RCD protected anyway. Unless I've got it in MI, or unless I've got it in steel wire armor cable, or unless I've put it in steel trunking, or steel conduit, or I've got at least a 3 millimeter thick metal plate on top of it to protect it from nails and screws and people deciding it'd be a good idea to stick a shelf up here. What about the other aspect then of those socket outlets that were for use for equipment outdoors, whether it was the lawnmower or the hedge trimmer or whatever? Well, that requirement still exists. It remains the same, it hasn't changed. So for socket outlets rated up to 32 amps that are for use for equipment outdoors, then they still have to be RCD protected. Again, 30 milliamp RCD. This risk assessment part, though, is a big hitter on this. It's going to have a significant impact on those of you that do commercial and industrial installations, because it's putting the onus back on the client. And well, that's got to be a good thing, hasn't it? It removes that ambiguity of, well, I thought that they were supposed to be supervised. Unless it specifically states in a risk assessment, then you've got to work upon the basis that they, doesn't matter if they're supervised or not, there's no risk assessment that details, no, we're accepting that risk because we've got these other measures in place. One of the other big changes is thanks to a piece of legislation called the Electricity Safety Quality and Continuity Regulations, the ESQCR. A lot of us remember that vaguely, but really don't have much to deal with it. Unless, of course, we're doing brand new installs, because they're the regulations that actually identify that the DNO must tell us the details of the supply in writing. But there's another requirement in it. Regulation 411.4.5 has now changed. It introduces a new factor. Before, it used to draw on just Ohm's law. Ohm's law basically said the impedance times the current was equal to the voltage. Do you agree? Ohm's law, yeah. They've now added this different factor. The voltage is now corrected via something called C-min. And C-min has been lifted directly from the ESQCR. On high voltage power distribution networks, when we come to the substation, most of the transformers can do multiple voltages or multiple load demands, and depends where the electrical connection is made on the windings of the transformer, or as they call it, the tap-offs, it will affect the voltage parameters of the supply that is actually available. And there's a factor that takes into account those variants with regards to how heavily the transformer is loaded, what sort of temperature the windings are reaching, and the physical tap-off connections. And they call this factor C-min. And C-min is a set value, 0.95. But what they say now is, well, hang on a minute, if the voltage at the source, at the substation, can actually change by a factor of 0.95, what impact will that have on the voltage that reaches the other end? Now, the significance of this formula was to identify that our earth fault loop impedance values times by the fault current that's going to flow will be less than the line voltage to earth, RMS. Now, what was RMS? Root mean square. It was the average or nominal voltage to earth, wasn't it? It was the DC equivalent to earth. But now they're telling us, but hang on a minute, that might not be at 230 volts. That could be lower than 230 volts. Now, this is different from the nominal supply between line and neutral. The nominal supply between line and neutral, we know, can be plus 10% or minus 6%. This is the line to earth voltage reference. So it's a different factor that we take into account. So it's not when we measure line and neutral we get, oh, look, we've got 253 volts here on a single phase installation. It's when we measure between line and earth and we actually get as low as 219 or 220 volts on a 230 volt system. What impact would that have then? Well, if we think about it, if the line to earth voltage here drops down to below 230 volts, simple Ohm's law says, well, if I know the voltage that I've got available and I know the current that must flow, then I can work out what the maximum opposition can be. You agree? We know that voltage divided by current will give us the opposition or impedance. So if my voltage drops, I mean, basic maths tells us this, if it's 100 volts and it's 20 amps that needs to flow, then we know that that's 5 ohms of impedance, isn't it? Quick check, hang on a minute, 100 divided by 20, yeah. But what if that 100 volts should drop to 50 volts? So now that's 50 volts divided by 20 amps. That's not going to give us the 5 ohms, is it? It's going to be 2.5 ohms. So what, bearing in mind the importance of ZS, the earth fault loop impedance, that's all about making sure that protective devices will disconnect before you or anyone using that installation gets hurt. That's what our disconnection times are all about. That's why the disconnection times under regulation 411.3.2 always talks about line to earth, because it's about protecting people. It's nothing to do with short circuits, it's nothing to do with overcurrents, it's everything to do with earth faults. It's when we touch something that isn't meant to be live and has become live and we give the path to earth. It's about providing our protection. So if I use the old values from the First Amendment, then I would be working to a much higher value of impedance. Now I know about C-min. That tells me the voltage here is going to drop, which tells me that the voltage here is going to drop, which tells me that the voltage here is going to drop. So the voltage has dropped along the entire circuit of the earth fault loop impedance, then the maximum amount of impedance has to be adjusted accordingly. Now, fortunately, that's what they've done in this third amendment. The SQCR identifies that C-min has a value of 0.95, and this factor equates to the voltage at the transformer. It's identifying that it gives us up to 218.5 as our nominal line to earth voltage. Bearing that in mind then, it's changed the tables. In the first amendment, standard type B circuit breaker, we'll remember the shortcut about working out the tripping currents, don't we? That it was 5 times its rating. Well, if we took a 32 amp, 5 times 32 was 160. 230 divided by 160 gave us 144. You agree? That was the maximum tabulated earth fault loop impedance that we could have. We then adjusted that, allowing for the temperature change in conductors. Our rule of thumb, our appendix 14. That still exists. However, that only takes into account the temperature change of the conductors within our installation. We always assumed, oh yes, but ZE would never change, would it? It would be always set. Well, now they're telling us actually ZE does change because of this C-min factor. So what they've done this time is now our 32 amp breaker, it still takes the 160 amps of fault current to make it operate, but this time it's not 230 volts that we divide it by. The 230 volts is no longer used, it's 230 times 0.95, which is the 218.5. 218.5 divided by 160 comes to the 137. So that's where these new numbers are coming from. What I then have to do is this 137, if I'm doing a measured value of ZS and I'm not doing it on a hot circuit, I'm doing it on initial verification, I then have to apply the 0.8 to that 1.37. The other thing that they've done is they've actually made this bit a little bit easier to understand. Whereas before, who really understood what 46 divided by IA was? But now they're saying, no, that's 230 volts times the 0.95 divided by 5 IN. Now we know what IN is. IN is the rating of the protective device. So it's saying 5 lots of it. So even the table's reminding you of the formula where these values have come from. Instead of putting it in some nice convoluted code. This applies to all protective devices. We chose the circuit breaker because it's the most common one that you'll use. But they've also expanded the range. The BS88-2 protective devices start at 2 amps, always have started at 2 amps. But the book never started at 2 amps, it always started at 6. Well, they've now put in the 2 amp ratings. The type D circuit breakers have always been a slight anomaly, haven't they? In that we've always worked on the fact of circuit breakers, they could achieve our standard 0.4 disconnection time and 5 seconds on a TN system with no problem, no variation. Until you actually started looking at the graphs in Appendix 3, and you actually saw on a D breaker that tripping current that they were identifying that would make it operate within 0.4 seconds, actually the 5 seconds was actually less current. It wasn't, the 5 second was actually happening in the thermal trip rather than the magnetic trip of the breaker. So the B's and C's, that was never a problem. But the D's, we were always overcompensating. So what they've done, on table 41.3, they've now added an extra section. We've got the section that talks about the 0.4 second disconnection time for TN arrangements. But then they've also added at the bottom the 0.5 second, the 5 second disconnection times. which is for final circuits above 32 amps and distribution circuits. Straight away we can see the difference that we were missing all this time. How many times have you installed a type D for a distribution circuit and you've struggled to meet the earth fault loop impedance? Well, this is why. You'd be trying to achieve half of what you actually had available to you. So they've now clarified that point and made it easier for us. Okay, it's given us an extra row on the table to understand, but they have marked it up so that you can clearly see one is for your 0.4s, so your finals up to 32 amps, and all your other circuits, the 5 second section, gives you a higher value of ZS to comply with. So what's the significance then of these values? Well, from the 1st of January, any property that I go out to do a periodic inspection on, these are the values of ZS I should be working to from now. It's only on brand new installations that I still get the lenience on initial verification to work to Amendment 1 or Amendment 2. Any periodics now I should be doing to these new values. That also cascades through onto the likes of reduced low voltage systems, you know, our 110 site supplies, as well as taking into account the changes in the standards for the protective devices. So those values have also dropped. For example, a 25 amp type C circuit breaker is no longer 0.22, it's 0.21. Wait a minute, that's gone down. Yeah. Again, it's the Siemens factor that has to be applied to take those factors into account. It hasn't changed that we still expect 55 volts between line and earth, or between neutral and earth. It's now applying the Siemens factor to that 55 volts to take that factor into account. Does that make sense? Getting some nods, that's a relief. It makes more sense when you get a chance to actually have a look at the tables yourself in your own time. The next regulation that has a significant impact to us is predominantly with regards to domestic installations. It's not such a big change with regards to existing industrial and commercial, but it is a significant change with regards to domestic installations. And I'm talking about this new one, Regulation 421.1.201. Some of you may have heard or seen some of the talks that the likes of the Electrical Safety First, which used to be the Electrical Safety Council, and the IET, and even London Fire Brigade have produced. The Electrical Safety First have a YouTube channel, and on there they talk about this. There was a study done by the London Fire Brigade that actually identified what sort of hazards their firefighters would experience when dealing with typical types of fires. And one of the most common fire that they identified in domestic dwellings in the London region was due to the consumer unit. They always managed to trace the source of the fire back to the consumer unit. Why is that? Why weren't they encountering the same sort of problems in industrial and commercial? Well, think about your consumer unit at home. What's it made out of? Plastic. Cheap, cheerful, simple to put up, lightweight, easy to conceal, nice and easy. Bish, bash, bosh, jobs are good 'em. But when you terminate the neutral conductor, typically the neutral bar is up near the top of the consumer unit. And some people, when they terminate, they get used to stripping off the 10 to 12 mil of insulation and sticking the conductor in and then screwing it down. And quite often, those neutrals would actually be pressing against the plastic casing. Now, that wasn't normally a problem. But a neutral is a live conductor. And as we know, under use, live conductors get hot. And if I then start putting a lot of load on that circuit, that neutral that's pressed against that plastic casing is going to get very hot. in a concentrated area, because all the heat of the conductor only has a small surface area to transfer onto the plastic, and this was causing some consumer units to ignite. So regulation 421.201 says, within domestic, in brackets, household premises, consumer units and similar switchgear assemblies shall comply with BSEN 61439-3. Well, that's good relief. Most of them comply with that. But it then goes on and shall have their enclosure manufactured from non-combustible material or be enclosed in a cabinet or enclosure constructed of non-combustible material and complying with regulation 132.12. Non-combustible. That's one of those magic terms. I wonder what that could possibly mean. Well, fortunately, they've gone as far as clarifying that term as well. And I'll just read from the regs as to what they define as non-combustible. They identify this non-combustible is the same as non-flame propagating, which says liable to ignite as a result of an applied flame, but after the flame is removed, does not propagate further and extinguishes itself within a limited time. Now, when this was first talked about, you can imagine the panic that manufacturers of switchgear had was, oh my goodness, half our consumer units, they're not non-combustible. They're just made out of nice, cheap and cheerful PVC. I mean, that's why you only want to pay £30 for a carcass, isn't it? You don't want this expensive metal-clad 60-pound carcass, do you? You just want, it's only domestic, it's just put in the nice, cheap job, yeah? It's not going to have bashing, it's not going to have corrosives, it's not going to have chemicals. It might get a little bit of paint on it, but there's not going to be oils or solvents thrown around by it. It's going to be out the way. People tend to know what a consumer unit is there for. Yeah. The problem is, though, the plastic they were using was flammable. Manufacturing often takes a long time to respond to changes. They normally put their effort in trying to resist the change because that's the way we've always done it. But they had to pay attention to this one. This is quite a significant change. So they've been given leeway. This regulation is not enforceable until the 1st of January 2016. This is the one regulation that there's a little bit of leeway on. It's understood that consumer units, they're going to take time to use up stocks in warehouses and things like that, and there will be a cascade time coming through. But from the 1st of January 2016, if you're dealing with a domestic installation and doing a brand new build, you must put in a non-flame propagating enclosure, whether that's the consumer unit itself or it's then put within a box. Me personally, I wouldn't waste my resource in putting it in a box. I'd put it that it's a non-flame propagating consumer unit. Now, does that automatically mean it's got to be metal? Well, the notes under the regulations suggest a metal one, but it doesn't have to be. Providing your consumer unit is guaranteed that it is of the type that's non-flame propagating, then happy days, you can still use plastics. Because not all plastics are flammable, are they? Some of them, all the time you stick a flame on, it will burn. As soon as you take it off, it goes out. And that's what that requirement is trying to identify. Because the way in which the PVC ones respond, as soon as they were lit, that was it, they went. It's a bit like when we have the plastic diffusers on lighting in ceilings. Once it's lit, it drips flaming globules of fire. It's quite exciting. But that's not a good idea to have in a domestic environment, is it? Why have they not mentioned this for commercial and industrial? Well, the last time I saw a plastic consumer unit being used in a commercial installation was when I was an apprentice. Because most commercial and industrial installations, they're far more robust, but it does lend itself to asking the question about those properties that is a commercial property and a dwelling because it's a shop with a house attached to it or a shop with a flat. Again, it has to come a guidance to say, if it complies with the requirements or scope of Part P, then it's a dwelling. And if it's a dwelling, then we need to make sure that we're making those suitable precautions. I hope you don't mind. I'm just going to close this window. Sorry about that. So does this mean that when I go out to do a periodic inspection in a dwelling, I'm going to condemn the installation because it's got a plastic consumer, am I? Well, what am I going to do? Well, I don't know about you. I can't stand in front of a consumer unit and 100% say whether or not that is flammable or not. I don't know. I'd have to investigate further. And we'll talk about some of the changes that are coming in with the periodic inspection with regards to that in a little while. We have to be careful with regards to installations that are there. We can always recommend that things are improved. We can't make things to be improved. But this aspect of fire safety is not the only aspect that has a significant impact. There's a whole new section for thermal effects under regulation group 424. I'll be honest with you, it's that big. So it's not a major concern. However, it does affect a niche market. And what the regulation says is it's talking about forced air heating systems, appliances producing hot water or steam, and space heating appliances. And it says locations containing forced air heating systems, appliances producing hot water or steam, and space heating appliances must comply with the appropriate parts of the building regulations. And that's all it says. It's the note afterwards, though, that brings a little bit more guidance. The Chartered Institute of Building Services Engineering identifies their codes of practice. And in their codes of practice, they have code H, code C, and code M. Now, what do they mean? Well, anyone designing a system that contains any one of those aspects has to design it in accordance with code H. And the code H is a full practical guide on what provisions you need to make, etc. So this is BS7671 acknowledging the fact that if you're doing this, if you want to say when you're certificating, yes, it was designed in accordance with BS7671, then you must have followed what code H says. And anyone then installing and commissioning, and even onto maintenance, must comply with code C and code M. So code H is the design, and code C and code M is about the actual installation and maintaining and commissioning of those systems. Again, whenever a periodic inspection is done, you need to make sure, is it being maintained in accordance with those codes? Again, that's something else we're going to have to read up on. Section 444, first introduced to us in the First Amendment, is about reducing the electromagnetic effects. We like to talk about surges and spikes and transient overvoltage and the damage that they can do and the interference that it can cause. So a whole new section was created with regards to that. They've changed it. Yeah. What? Hang on a minute. It only came out in 2011 and now they've changed. Yes, but they've only changed one aspect of it. They realised they made a typo. Came in Amendment 1 and said those involved in the design of electrical installations. It now says those involved in the design, construction and installation and maintenance of electrical systems need to make sure they're complying with section 444. So all it's done is it hasn't changed the content of it, it's just said, hang on a minute, it's not just about the designer. Because we know when people go in and make changes, even if they're filling out just a minor electrical installation work certificate, they need to do an aspect of design. But you know as well as I do, if you're changing like, how much design work do you do? I'll be honest, you just go up, oh, it's that one, yeah, I've got one of those, I'll just fit that in its place. But what it's now saying is you need to make sure that that component that you're fitting in its place is going to provide the right level of protection with regards to electromagnetic interferences. So how are you going to be aware of that? Well, the first thing is establish, is this a sensitive installation? Are you dealing with sensitive equipment? Have you got circuits that are going to be susceptible to electromagnetic interference? If they're not, then it's not a problem. Quite a lot of changes in part four, wasn't there? The words you're looking for is, yes, James. No, okay, perhaps not. Sorry, I'm getting some signals. That one there, sorry, I'm getting a request for closing another window. I do apologise. Okay, part five then. With regards to part five, we've got a number of changes, again, significant changes, I think also a mixture of minor changes. The biggest change is the updating of the BSCN numbers throughout. Changing of the standards, changing of the numbers accordingly. We've also got wording change significantly in here with regards to trying to make things a bit clearer. And where we used to have a requirement that was perhaps spread across three or four different regulations, they've reworded it and made it a bit more basic so it then sits across one or two regulations at the most. The favourite one, of course, was, if you remember, when you were burying cables in the walls, there was one regulation that said you just make sure they're in prescribed zones. And it wasn't until you read a few regulations later that it said, oh, by the way, if you put it in prescribed zones and there's no other mechanical protection, you've got to RCD protect it. So it was understandable that quite a few people would look at that would say, oh yeah, it's in prescribed zones, happy days, I've done my job. And they wouldn't realise that later regulation. So by rearranging how some of the regulations have been put, we've made it a bit clearer. Renumbering of the regulations also to reflect the use of the 200 series. So where we had a lot of 100s, they've moved then into the 200s in preparation for the 18th edition. But you don't want to know about that, do you?
No.
521.10. When you're on a site and it's 10 to midnight and you need an elbow on your trunking and you've forgotten it. And so you just make one up. We've all been there. Or it's been a Sunday and you know that there's no wholesaler around and you've called all your mates and nobody's got one yet. You've got to have this back up and running by Monday morning. So you make it. It's one of the things that a lot of apprentices struggle, well, why do I have to know how to make this? I'll just go and buy one. They don't realise the impact that it can have if you can't make things on site. However, BS7671, this section specifically here, says, yeah, that's all well and good making it on site. However, how can you guarantee that the bit that you've made maintains the same structural integrity as the parts that you purchased? Now, it's not talking about the straight parts that we cut. It's talking about the bends, the elbows, the sets that we fabricate on site when we have to. And what it's saying here is it places a responsibility on the person that constructs it and installs it to make sure that it is built correctly. Now, you'll know as well as I do, if you do a lot of periodic inspections in commercial and industrial installations, you'll quite often come across a part and you'll think, who on earth made this? This is absolutely atrocious. Well, this is now putting the responsibility back in the place that it should be to make sure that it does conform to the right requirements. The number of times that I've seen that a containment system has to comply with IP3X and you've gone there and there's a big hole in it. No seal on it whatsoever, and I can quite easily stick my hands and stuff in it. So it's not to the right requirements. So this is about making sure that when we do make those parts, we make them correctly. New requirement though. Fire brigade research, again, has led people to identify the most common injury encountered to fire brigades is things falling down on top of them. Especially when they're going into blocks of flats or commercial properties that have got suspended ceilings like this. The little metal wires that hold the suspended ceiling up give way and the whole lot collapses on, especially in escape routes. Or even worse, it falls down above a fire exit and we got masses of cable there and somebody can't get through the door. They can't pull the door open, they can't push the door from the other side because you've got all these cables, etc. Or even worse, it actually falls and lands on the firefighter. So they've added this new requirement, 521.11.201. It appears on page 127, if you're keeping track of page numbers. And it says, wiring systems in escape routes shall be supported such that they will not be liable to premature collapse in the event of fire. The requirements of Regulation 422.2.1 shall also apply irrespective of the classification of the conditions for evacuation in emergency. And then it's got a couple of notes and it talks about non-metallic cable clips, cable ties, trunking, etc. are not acceptable across escape routes. So how do we get round it? Well, one of the suggestions is the use of steel lined tie wraps. Great, marvellous. However, how practical is that? Not always practical. So what other options do I have? Well, if I've got a cable in a ceiling section, if I put metal brackets out so that should that collapse, it's going to then fall and drop into the metal brackets and can't go any further, then I've met that requirement. So it's about bringing in a bit of lateral thinking, as it were, in that, okay, it might drop, but how do I stop it from going any further? And metal brackets such as those, hooks and straight brackets, can be retrofitted, can't they? So it's not a major task to do it. Obviously, the ideal solution would be to use a suitable containment that isn't going to melt, isn't going to give way, and isn't going to collapse. We've had people in the past saying, yeah, but what about then when they secure it into the wall and they use nylon wall plugs, raw plugs? Yeah, they could melt and then it will fall out. Yeah, okay, let's put a realm of realistic expectations on this. We don't really expect something buried within the wall to get so hot that it's going to melt and give way. You agree? It is going to get hot over time, but we've got to remember what the purpose is. And the fact that it talks about escape routes, this does not apply to dwellings unless it's in something like a block of flats where there are shared evacuation routes. So the simple way to think about this is whether or not you're going to put it up is, first of all, has the client defined what their evacuation routes are? And in order to define what their evacuation routes are, then they're needing to consider the fire detection and alarm requirements that are outlined in the appropriate standards. So again, this is feeding back to a better liaison with the customer. Me personally, I'd make sure I get that documented as well. It's not expecting you to design their fire system for them, but it is expecting you to be aware of when we're crossing over escape routes. Not necessarily going through the escape route, but going above the escape route, we need to make sure that we make suitable precautions to ensure that the cable collapse is not going to happen. The 522.6.1 point 100 section has been changed to the point 200 section. And whereas before we had a regulation that says when you bury cables in a wall at a depth of less than 50 mil from the surface, you'll either have metallic containment or you'll have a suitably armoured cable or mineral insulated cable, or you'll have conduit or trunking or a metal plate, or you'll run it in prescribed zones, or it'll be part of an extra low voltage circuit or an SELV circuit. They've changed all that bit. They've made it simpler by saying a cable installed in a wall or a partition at a depth of less than 50 mil from a surface of the wall or partition shall be, and then it talks about prescribed zones, be installed in a zone within 150 mil from the top of the wall. So again, it describes what the zones are. And then it goes on to say, or comply with regulation 522.6.204, which were all the other options. But within the same regulation, it says, where the first option is identified, but not the second option, the cable shall be provided with additional protection by means of an RCD. So it's now within that one regulation saying, yeah, you can install it in prescribed zones, or you can do all those other bits as well. But if you just do it in prescribed zones and you don't do any of the others, then you must have an RCD. So there's no having to look elsewhere to find the RCD requirement. It's there within the regulation. That makes it a lot easier for those coming into the industry that are starting to think, right, well, okay, how does this go? And it also makes it easier for us to explain to those people, and also those people that have been in the industry for 20, 30 years, that, well, 15th, 16th edition qualified. I'm sure you all know at least one of those people, to explain to them, no, this is why it's changed to here, and now you have to do this. So it gives a bit more clarity with regards to those requirements, rather than sticking it as a sideline on another regulation. Section 557, auxiliary circuits. New section. So what is an auxiliary circuit? Well, again, I'm going to go back to the definitions. Something that I always try and drill into anyone that I'm talking to about the regs is, if you don't understand the term, see if it tells you first of all. It's always the best place to go for. And it says an auxiliary circuit is a circuit for transmission of signals intended for control, detection, supervision or measurement of the functional status of a main circuit. So it's not a main circuit. It's anything that's going to help me with the monitoring or the control. So the type of circuits that I'm thinking about with regards to these start bringing in control panels, control systems, building management systems, telemetry, the use of functional extra low voltage. I now need to start thinking about auxiliary circuits, or whether it is an auxiliary circuit. And what it does is it breaks down the requirements quite specifically, item by item, with regards to what needs to be provided with regards to those circuits. It talks about the types of sources that we can use. underneath the requirement, it tells me where I might get the supply from, whether it's from a transformer, whether it's from a battery. It also talks about the level of protection that I need to include for those specific auxiliary requirements. It also tells me, under regulation 557.4.1, the minimum cross-sectional areas that are permitted. Now, they are slightly different from the requirements as outlined in section 521, which is the standard main circuit conductor, identifying that for lighting and power for copper conductors, a minimum cross-sectional area of 1 millimetre squared is permitted. Whereas when I then come to it being an auxiliary circuit, it says that where it's a control circuit and it's a single core cable, I'm down to 0.5 millimetre squared cable. So it's permitting a smaller cross-sectional area for the use of auxiliary circuits. So this is quite a thing to identify if you're involved in a lot of industrial or telemetry or monitoring systems. It also picks up on the relaxation for where it is telemetry signals or IT signals, because then it can be 0.1 millimeter squared. So there's similar requirements with regards to that. Section 559 has been changed slightly. Section 559 was just all about lighting, wasn't it? Anything you wanted to know about lighting, irrespective of where it was, that was the one section you had to remember. Nice and easy, wasn't it? Until you had to think, well, hang on a minute, is this special or not? This is outdoors, well, this is extra low volt. Is it really a special installation? So what they've decided to do is they've decided to take those two very topics, outdoor lighting and extra low voltage lighting, and make them special installations. Makes it a lot easier to understand. So outdoor lighting is now covered under section 714, and extra low voltage lighting has now moved to section 715. The rest of the lighting requirements remains as is. Obviously there's the subtle changes with regards to standard numbers changing and IEC numbers changing, but the rest of it is pretty much the same as it used to be. There's another new section though, and that falls under safety services. And I haven't put it on the PowerPoint because it's really quite a big one. It's regulation group 560.11, and it consists of two lines. 560 is talking about safety systems, and 560.11 talks about life safety and firefighting applications. And all it says is the selection and installation of power and control cable systems which are required to maintain their circuit integrity for life safety and firefighting applications shall comply with the relevant parts of BS8519. So simple as that. All it's saying is we acknowledge now these are special requirements and therefore have to meet with a special standard. So can I just use my standard BS6004 wiring? Definitely not. That other standard then identifies the requirements of those cables, including the sizing of them and their fire withstand properties, as well as their structural integrity. And that's really all that's changed in part five. Not much, eh? No? Well, realistically, when we think about it, no, not much has changed. Okay, we now understand about the big change about consumer units in a domestic dwelling. But if you don't deal with domestic dwellings, that's no change to you. If all you do is domestic dwellings, then that's a significant change. The other change, main change, is with regards to escape routes. And if you just deal with domestic and you don't tend to get into blocks of flats or commercial or industrial properties, then again, that's not going to affect you. So it's only really if you've got one foot in either camp that you have to deal with both changes. The other changes, the moving of the parts out of the lighting section into their own specific special sections, isn't really making that significant alteration. It's just making it a bit easier to find and a bit easier to specialise. Part six, well, do you think the requirements for inspection and testing will have changed immensely? Well, I certainly hope not. To that extent, apart from the change in certain terminologies, no. We still have to inspect and test the same way as we've always done. However, with regards to the documentation we issue, yes, there have been some changes. How many of you like the electrical installation condition report that came out in Amendment 1 with regards to the inspection schedule, where everything was broken down that said, if you wanted to tick here, this is the regulation that you need to think about? That was a massive leap forward, wasn't it? Yeah. Well, guess what? They've done the same with the initial verification. The schedule of inspections now has been physically changed from that guest tick box. Come on, let's be honest. How many people can we list on, well, probably don't have enough hands, that would argue about the different meaning for each different box? The number of times you'd sit, even with the experts, They'd sit round a table, no, that box actually means this. No, it doesn't, it means this. And there was always that ambiguity around it. So how on earth were we, as people that were using the documents, expected to understand from those four or five words what on earth that box meant? Well, they've changed that. They've done exactly the same as they did on the condition report, in that now the schedule is a series of text with a regulation number next to it. So before you say, yes, that's compliant, you have to understand that's what the regulation says it should be. In order for me to say, yes, that's compliant, I need to understand what that regulation states. That makes it an awful lot easier, doesn't it? There's no guesswork. Well, I thought that meant that. Well, no, it said that. So that's what you were looking for. And if it's meant to be there and it's not, then you know what to do. If it's not meant to be there, then happy days. If it's meant to be there, you now know what it's exactly meant to be, and therefore whether or not it complies. So that's a massive leap forward, in my simple mind, in making it a lot easier to make sure that our documentation actually means something. Because when all's said and done, if it's just a sheet that nobody really understands why they're ticking it, what's the value of doing it? Part 7, as we mentioned, has had some changes. The first change comes in our location containing a bath or shower. Remember this regulation number, 411.3.3, that's the one we said had changed about RCDs. Now originally this regulation said that all circuits within the location must be RCD protected. So what about the circuit that didn't stop in that location, that was just passing through? That just got ignored. But hang on a minute, isn't that still got a risk of being damaged and presenting a shock potential within that location? Of course it has. So they've actually clarified this a bit. It now requires that all circuits that serve the location, that was the original requirements, and all those that pass through zones 1 and or zone 2. Now, just to remind ourselves, zone 0 is the bath, i.e. where the water is held, where you sit or where you stand. Depends if you like to lie down in the bath or it's just a small one. Zone 1 is the area that goes around the perimeter of the bath up to a ceiling height a top height of 2.25 metres from the floor level. It's the area that you occupy when you're either sitting in the bath or standing in the bath. And zone 2 was if you were sitting or standing in the bath and you could reach out your hand, that would then go into zone 2. And so what they said was 600 millimetres from the edge of zone 1 would be the edge of zone 2, again to the same height. 2.25 metres. So the sort of area that you might just accidentally reach out. Obviously, they didn't take into account people might reach further than that, but then there's a certain amount of intent. This was about protecting you from accidental contact. So now they're saying is that any circuit that passes through any of those zones also has to be RCD protected, irrespective of whether or not it's being terminated there. Now, I was thinking the other night, what possible circuit could do that? And I couldn't think of a circuit that wasn't already RCD protected that would actually be introducing that sort of scenario. So if you ever come up with one, please email me one. I'd really love to know. It's there for when we do come across that scenario. It's trying to make it so that it's removing... Yeah, but it wasn't a circuit in that area. So I didn't think it needed to be. It's removing those parts. It doesn't care whether or not it's in that area or if it's using that area as a shortcut. Then it must be RCD protected. On page 256... it starts talking about section 714, outdoor lighting installations. as it says here, specific to outdoor lighting have moved from section 559 to section 714. So what sort of area does it cover? Well, as we know, any special location or any special installation, as soon as it's in the part sevens, it starts off with the scope. And it says, this section applies to outdoor lighting installations comprising of one or more luminaires, a wiring system and accessories to the highway power supplies and street furniture. The following are included. Lighting installations such as those for roads, parks, car parks, gardens, places open to the public, sporting areas, illumination of monuments and floodlighting. Other lighting arrangements in places such as telephone kiosks, bus shelters, advertising panels and town plans, and of course road signs. The following are excluded. Temporary festoon lighting, luminaires fixed to the outside of a building and supplied directly from the internal wiring of that building, and road traffic signal systems. So, okay, you're at home and you decide it'd be a really good idea if you had some lights dotted around your garden to illuminate it, make it look all nice. Does that have to comply with these requirements now? Yeah, it does. It's only if I'm deciding I'm going to put a floodlight on the side of my house to illuminate my patio area, or a security light to flood up the whole of my garden. But as soon as I start taking the wiring out into the garden, I am leaving the building, then this applies. All the time that the wiring and everything stays on the building, then it's just straightforward lighting point. As soon as I start taking it out into that higher risk environment, then I've got to comply with this. The way in which we like to think about it is it's going back to the old scope of Part P. As soon as you cross the garden, it's special. Because you've got to start thinking about how you're going to protect that gable. How is it going to be, you know, protected from animals, rodents, plants, roots, or even people digging? These are the considerations that need to be borne. However, it also talks about 714.512.3. And what it says there is with regards to ground recessed luminaires. It says, for ground recessed luminaires, the selection and erection shall take account of the guidance given in Table A1 of BSEN 60598-2-13. Now, this probably isn't something that I'm a fan of. That seems to be a, oh yeah, you've got to comply with this. Well, hang on a minute, I'm going to this one-stop shop. So perhaps we might see in the 18th edition they actually publish that table in this. All it's just saying though is when I've got a lamp that I'm putting in the floor, of course it's going to be special. It's going to have people walking on it. It might even have vehicles travelling over it. So of course it's got to comply with a higher standard. I've got to make sure that it's going to be able to withstand that, as well as it'll be a pool for any water seeping through thanks to rainfalls and things like that. So it's going to be a special fitment and a special installation. This is a key one. Under isolation and switching, it says every circuit shall be capable of being isolated individually from each of the live supply conductors, except as detailed in 537.1.2. 537.1.2 talks about the different earthing arrangements and when you can break the neutral. But it says quite clearly that if it's a single phase supply, you must break both line and neutral when you're performing your main switch isolation. So if I'm having to isolate, say I've got an installation and it's got a car park, and I've got lighting going out to the car park, and there's multiple circuits that are doing the lighting, each one of those circuits must be able to be isolated by at least a double pole switch. I must break line and neutral. I can't just rely now on a single pole circuit breaker to isolate that. And I have to be able to do it on each lighting circuit. So do I need them to be RCD protected? Might be an idea. So be careful when you're buying your RCBOs. Make sure the switching mechanism is a double pole switching mechanism, not the standard, which is a single pole. A lot of RCBOs only break the line conductor. They don't break the neutral. Therefore, it's something you have to bear in mind when you're installing those systems. You must break both live conductors. Similar sort of requirement as you have with rechargeable vehicles. Again, each rechargeable vehicle circuit must be able to be isolating both live conductors. Yeah, it's making it a little bit tricky now, isn't it? Section 715 talks about extra low voltage lighting installations. They're specific with requirements to those sort of circuits. They're the type that I might have a transformer and then a rail coming out with all the lamps. I just slide along the rail to wherever I want them and screw them in. Or it can even be when I'm using extra low voltage lighting to illuminate my garden and things like that, because I might have thought, haha, I could get around this outdoor lighting requirement and I'll just put in extra low voltage lighting system. Fantastic, done. With regards to this, you'll get some of them that have got self-resetting thermal trips. I.e. if you overload them or you leave them on for too long, they cut out. And once they've been off for a period of time, or you've switched them off again, you press a manual reset button and off you go. Happy days. They're only allowed up to a maximum of 50 VA, which when you think about it, extra low voltage at 50 VA, that's one sizable circuit, isn't it? That's a massive circuit. But also, under 715.521.1 tells you what type of wiring systems are suitable for extra low voltage lighting. And it says, following wiring systems shall be used: either insulated conductors in conduit systems according to BSEN 61386 series, or in cable trunking or ducting systems, rigid cables, flexible cables, systems for ELV lighting, track systems, and of course bare conductors. Where parts of the extra low voltage lighting installation are accessible, the requirements of section 423 also apply, which are about protecting people from getting burnt. Metallic structural parts of buildings, for example, pipe systems or parts of furniture, shall not be used as live conductors. I wonder why. Yeah, we fall into the trap of thinking it's extra low voltage. That isn't a problem, because we can touch extra low voltage. Yeah, but in certain circumstances, a 9-volt battery can kill you. Remember, it's not the voltage that is the thing that does the damage. It's the amount of current that can flow in those sorts of circumstances. It does go on to say, though, the limits. 715, and this is one of the points that was a typo on yours. It says on this that it's about the maximum volt drop. Is that correct on your handouts? Yes, I do apologise. Got too excited with the fingers. Started writing about the next bit I wanted to save instead of finishing this one off. So I apologise for that. We will get that sorted for you. So the first thing is, it limits the voltage. Touch voltage, when we're dealing with extra low voltage, is reduced to 25 volts AC or 60 volts DC, moving away from the 50 volts. With regards to this though, 721.525, it identifies volt drop as 5%. Now why is that significant? Well, it's significant because typically in Appendix 4, it identifies that the maximum volt drop for lighting circuits is of course 3% of nominal voltage. So if I've got extra low voltage lighting, I can go up to 5% on the volt drop, but that's only on the extra low voltage side. On the LV side, it's still back to the 3%. The other requirement talks about, as it says there, contains the requirements for extra low voltage equipment which is located above a full ceiling. Let's just have a look at that. 530.3.104, it says, protected devices may be located above full ceilings, which are removable or easily accessible. That means the ceiling panels, not the protected devices, okay? provided that information is given about the presence and location of such devices. So yeah, I can put the protective devices for it up there, as long as I make somehow somebody aware that that protective device is up there, and this is how you get to it. It's a bit like if I want to put junction boxes underneath flooring. Yeah, I can do that, but I've got to make sure it's accessible, and I need to make sure that it's documented where those accessible points are, because then every point, every junction needs to be accessible for inspection and testing. So again, we're having to make sure that, yeah, you can stick them up there, but just make sure people are aware. Now, does that include if I've used a socket outlet with a plug, a plug-in transformer? Possibly, it all depends. Would I expect that protective device to be accessible? Would I expect that protective device to be the protective device for that circuit, etc., etc.? Should I really be using a plug-in transformer for these extra low voltage lighting? Probably not. So it's putting a bit of sense or common factor around that point. It also goes on to say, with regards to that, if the identification of a protective device for a circuit is not immediately evident, a sign or diagram in the form of a label close to the protective device shall identify the circuit and its purpose. SELV sources, protective devices or similar equipment mounted above false ceilings or in a similar place shall be permanently connected. So that answers your question about the plug-in one. It goes on to say that SELV sources and their protective devices shall be installed so as to avoid mechanical stresses on their electrical connections and be adequately supported and avoid overheating of the equipment due to thermal insulation. What, so you mean I can't just cover these with loft insulation? No, it's no different from any normal circuit. Just because it's a lower voltage does not mean it's not going to get hot. I've still got to give it the same consideration as I would do a standard circuit. The final requirement that is identified on this page is 715.537.1.1, which basically talks about transformers. If I've got multiple transformers to do a cascade arrangement, for whatever reason, then a single means of isolation must isolate all the supplies, as it says there. Requires that parallel connected transformers have their primaries isolated by a common isolator. So all the primary inputs must go through one isolator. And again, we're considering with regards to isolation, breaking of all live conductors in accordance with the requirements of section 537. Mobile or transportable units, number of changes. Basically, the harmonisation document for mobile or transportable units has been changed. One of the main requirements, 717.413. 717.413 talks about the protective measure of electrical separation. And when you read through the regulation, it makes sense why they've put this change in. It now says, electrical separation can be provided by the use of a transformer providing simple separation, e.g. meeting the requirements of BSEN 61558-1 in accordance with regulation 413.1.3, and it shall be used only where an insulation monitoring device is installed to provide automatic disconnection of the supply in the case of a first fault between live parts and the conductive structure of the unit, or an RCD and an earth electrode are installed to provide automatic disconnection in the case of failure of this transformer providing the electrical separation. Each socket outlet intended to supply current using equipment outside the unit shall be protected individually by an RCD having the characteristics specified in regulation 415.1.1. So what is a mobile transportable unit? Well, if you think about it, if you go to your local supermarket and there in the car park is your breastfeeding truck that's basically a trailer off a lorry that they've pulled up, parked up and connected a supply to it, that is a mobile or transportable unit. Or where there's been a major incident and there needs to be on-site coordination of the emergency services and they arrive with one of those trucks that basically has its own generator and they can coordinate and broadcast and keep everyone in touch, everyone in the loop, that is a mobile transportable unit. So with regards to the requirements of this, it's trying to clarify the fact that if we've got a fault and we're using electrical separation as our means of keeping people safe, and we've got a fault on the supply side, what can that potentially do? Well, it's in locations where there is Joe Public around. And in a situation where there's Joe Public around, there's a higher risk of somebody touching something and something else when they shouldn't be. You agree? And therefore, if there's a fault on the supply side, we can't rely on the electrical separation to provide the protection, because it's on the non-isolated or non-separated part of the system. So we've got to add in that extra protection, either by insulation monitoring or, of course, by the RCD. Some of you sit and say, that was fascinating. However, this one might sound a little bit obvious. Number of times, though, that you see mobile transportable units that they have their own generator, and then they also connect into a supply from the local shop or something. They might run both at the same time. What's the problem with that? Well, for starters, they won't be in synchronism, so there might be a big bang when you try and close breakers, etc. But the other thing is that the earths, you don't really want to be livening up one system on an earth fault when the other one occurs. So what it's saying here is it prohibits the interconnection of units with different power supply systems, also prohibits the interconnection of different earthing arrangements. So if I'm going to run it off mains, then I'll run it off mains. If I'm going to run it off generator, then I'll run it off generator. I don't try and do both at the same time. The systems aren't designed to do that in the first place. And there should be mechanical and electrical interlocks that prevents that from happening. But where there's an interlock, there's always somebody willing to try and find a way around it. Where we have then, under mobile or transportable units, the requirements of rotating generation, it gives us another section that we need to consider. This is shown on page 264, and it basically states, a generating set used as an additional source of supply in parallel with another source shall only be connected on the supply side of all the protective devices for the final circuits of the installation. Protective conductors, including earthing conductors from different earthing systems, shall only be interconnected where suitable precautions have been taken into account. See also regulation 542.1.3.3. I saw this done about 10 years ago. Their supply that was available to them couldn't generate enough energy. It kept on tripping their main breaker. So what they did was they brought along a generating set and they connected it via an existing final circuit into the existing installation. I wondered why things went bang. Yeah, not a smart idea to take a 100 amp supply in through a 32 amp ring final. Yeah, this is about making sure that when the system isn't intended to do that, it's also about making sure that there's no physical way in which they can then adapt that on. Of course, as we know, where there's a will, there is always a dead person, yeah? No? Oh, wait, that's it. Oh, where there's a way. Okay. This is basically reinforcing the general rules that we have with regards to parts 1 to 6 to say, just because it's a mobile source, just because it's a mobile unit, is still an installation and should still be treated as if you would normally. For example, you wouldn't dream, well, perhaps you might do, of plugging in an extension lead with a plug into your neighbour's socket outlet, running it through your garden into your socket outlet and put another plug on it, and then switching off your main incomer, would you? Right, you might. Or even leaving it on and seeing if the meter goes backwards. No? Okay. Perhaps not. Section 722 then has now been fully incorporated. Electric vehicle charging. It's no longer a separate document that you have to get hold of. It's now fully immersed within the Third Amendment. Again, though, one of the key requirements is the need to be able to break both live conductors. Now, with regards to performing electrical installations for electric vehicle charging, if you'd asked me this question a couple of months ago, is there a qualification that I need to get in order to install electrical vehicle charging? I just said, as an electrician, you can figure it out. There's not much to worry. Oh my goodness, how wrong I would have been. I went and did the City and Guilds 2919 qualification for installing electric vehicle charging. And I was amazed at how much extra information you need to be aware of before you can start installing electric vehicle stations for public charging. Even with regards to putting it on a domestic property, on somebody's driveway, there are loads of extra considerations and loads of extra requirements that don't quite come across as clearly as they should in BS7671. So if you are looking at doing this, this is a well worth qualification to get. I believe there are steps in place that in order for you to do this for certain local authorities, you will need to be a member of their accreditation scheme, which means that you'll need to have this qualification. Whether or not that will actually take off or not, don't quote me on that. You need to scrub that bit from the film. No, I'm only joking. With regards to it though, don't fall into the trap that I fell in thinking that I can just read the special requirements for it and think I'll know everything, because there are other things such as permits, such as filling systems, such as tariffs, such as earthing arrangements that totally changes how you look at doing an EV charging position. So yeah, sales bit over. If you want to do it, inquire. Christos is at the back and so is Kirsten. They're more than willing to talk to you about those sort of aspects at the end. It's definitely worth doing. 722.531.2.101 was the regulation that states every charging station must have isolation for all live conductors. So again, with single phase supplies, it's finding a double pole means of isolation. You can't just rely on the circuit breaker that's feeding from the consume unit to be your means of isolation. Unlike what we do in majority of installations where that is adequate isolation, we need to provide additional isolation for there. So what about the appendices? Well, we're near the end of our journey, our quick whistle stop tour through the changes of BS7671. Appendix 1, as we would expect, with the additions of new standards, with the additions of new IEC numbers, changes of BSEN, this requirement, this section within BS7671 has changed quite a bit. The introduction of the new standards being mentioned, and also, if we remember, it also references where they're being used. So some of the regulation numbers have changed as well. Appendix 2, as we know, statutory legislation, especially things like the building regulations, have been updated since the first 17th edition was issued, and therefore those have been updated and tweaked and adjusted accordingly. It doesn't mean, therefore, that BS7671 no longer provides you cover for those. It's just saying, oh, this is the most latest edition. Appendix 3 is still the time characteristic graphs. But what we have to bear in mind now is the factor of C-min has changed with regards to those graphs. And therefore, it's changing the formula that is being used for the maximum tabulation. It doesn't actually change the graphs as such, but it does change how we establish our ZS value from those graphs. And if you remember, it used to have that little formula that said ZS was U0 divided by IA. Now it says that ZS equals U0 times C-min divided by IA. That's the only change that appears there. What has changed is with regards to certain of the graphs, figure 3A3 now includes the 2 amp fuse, and figure 3AC now includes the 250 to the 1250 amp fuses. So we've now got the whole range, rather than just the bit that was commonly used. We also see now the characteristics for the BS88-2 bolted type fuse being introduced. Type D circuit breakers, now instead of just having the one column like the type B and the type C, it will now have multiple columns to identify the differences between the various disconnection times. Appendix 4, reference is made to a new document for calculating impedances and fault currents, etc. But apart from that, it doesn't really change the way in which we perform our cable calculations. Appendix 5, there's one that haven't changed in any shape, manner or form. Appendix 6, there's some changes that have been made, some small ones to the electrical installation certificate. As I mentioned earlier, that section now that says has a risk assessment being performed with regards to the socket outlets has been added in, but the rest of it is pretty much the same as what it used to be. The schedule of inspections, as I mentioned to you earlier, now has gone away from being the little tick box. It's now a proper document that you can reference the regulation number, look it up, see what it's required, and mark it accordingly. However, we've also seen some changes being made to the electrical installation condition report. We've added a new code. We know we've got the C1, the C2, and the C3. Now we've got the F1. Now we're not going racing. I know, getting excited then. What's the F1? Well, if you remember, at the foot of page 2 of the condition report, it said observations made. And it would have there the detail of the observation, the code you gave it, and then another column that said further investigation required. The same was on the condition report inspection schedule. It had that column, further, and you had to put N, didn't you? You had to put that, no, I know what the problem is, it's obvious. I don't need to go and investigate whether or not this is a C1 or a C. Because, to be honest with you, if you can identify it as a C1, a C2, or a C3, what do you really need to investigate? The whole purpose of the condition report was saying whether or not it was satisfactory or not. If you're able to allocate a C code to it, you're not fault finding. It's not compliant. What more do you need to investigate? The cause? Well, that's not to do with that document. However, what about the ones that you felt, I don't know whether it's a C1 or a C2, it might even be a C3, I'm not quite sure. And then we'd need further investigation, you agree? This is where the F1 comes in now. We don't put C1, C2, C3 if we can't definitively say that's what it is. If we think, oh, I need to investigate that a bit further, I need to do some testing on that to find out if it is a C1. It looks like that insulation is a little bit melted, but I'm not sure if it's melted beyond the performance characteristics, and it's outside of my agreed sample plan. It's outside of where I'm allowed to go. Well, I'm not sure if that's an old problem or if it's a current problem, if it's a reoccurring problem. Okay. Oh, I think some further testing and further investigation is required for this F1. With regards to it being an F1, we then have to think about how that then has an impact. I was talking to some health and safety enforcement officers a couple of weeks ago, and they're responsible for making sure that electricians are doing the electrical safety as periodics as they're supposed to. And one of the questions that came out was, if somebody identifies something as a C1 or a C2, how long do they get to fix it? Well, on the electrical installation condition report, there is a section in there that says if you've identified it as unsatisfactory, it needs to be retested by this date. That implies put right, then retested after this date. Not, oh, this is going to be the anniversary of when it's next due. You're setting a deadline that when you've identified it as a C1 or a C2, that's the date by which it must be done. And that's the date by which it must be rechecked. Because if we think about why are we doing this, we're doing a periodic inspection because somebody wants to know, is this installation still safe to use? Or if we've marked it as unsatisfactory, then it's in their interest to get it done as quickly as possible. And if we're not putting in a short deadline, if we're saying, oh, 12 months, on some instances that might be realistic. But when it comes to somebody's safety, if it's a C1, how comfortable would you feel in putting down, oh, yeah. As long as you get it sorted out sometime in the next year, that immediately dangerous situation, yeah. So it's about putting across some consideration with regards to those times, but also removing the ambiguity for people putting down, I think it's a C1, but it needs further investigation to find out. If you don't know what it is, then you now use the F1 code. Okay? We're nearly there, I promise you. Appendix 7. There's no changes to it. Appendix 8, all they've done, if you remember, Appendix 8 is about bus bar systems. It's a bit of a cop-out, really, because it just says, if you're going to install bus bar systems, you've got to comply with this standard, this standard, this standard, this standard, this standard, manufacturer's information, this standard. All they've done is they've changed some of the standard numbers that it related to. So again, the easiest way to size bus bar systems is to go to the manufacturer of the bus bar system and get them to do all the paying. Appendix 9, 10, no changes. Appendix 11 and 12 are still deleted. Yeah, they were deleted in the First Amendment. If you remember, the information was moved to other parts within the regulations. Appendix 13, no changes. Appendix 14, that has changed with regards to the CMIN again. But if you remember, our actual application of Appendix 14 hasn't really changed. If you remember, we take the tabulated value and we times it by 0.8. That's how we apply Appendix 14. And that's all this is. This is the tabulated value. The nice thing is they're putting the tables now where that value comes from. So we've got this. We know that's the tabulated value. All we've got to remember is to times it by 0.8 when it's a measured value to establish what the maximum permitted measured value can be if it's not at its normal operating temperature. The key thing to remember with these is it always works upon the rule of thumb for thermoplastic cables because that's the worst case scenario. Thermosettings will give you a much better chance of achieving the withstand temperature, but we always work for worst case scenario. Appendix 16, again, regulation reference numbers, the standards, etc., and any regulation that it cross refers to has changed, but again, Appendix 16 has not changed at all. So, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our short seminar about the changes in BS7671. I hope it's been informative to you. I hope it hasn't put you off. One last thing, though. How many of you have heard about the dodgy copies of this? Some of you might even have been stung yourselves in getting a dodgy copy of it. Even though you might have bought it from what you believe to be a reputable source, such as Amazon. The IET were concerned about that. Concerned about that to the point that now the new book will have a hologram inside it. If you purchase a book that doesn't have a hologram inside it, it is not an authentic copy. Do not buy it. Send it back. Get your money refunded. And if possible, let the IET know that you purchased it through a certain source. Amazon are going to be working in partnership with obviously trading standards in that they were so concerned with how many copies went through them from the First Amendment. So if you do buy it through Amazon, make sure you let them know you've bought a dodgy copy. However, all the ones that we sell here, is that nicely slid in there? We've cloned the, no, we haven't cloned it. The ones that you will get from here, if you do buy them through here, will of course be the authenticated copy. But that's just a simple check for you to make sure that what you're buying is the correct stuff. Because in the First Amendment, when these new versions were coming in, or these dodgy copies were coming in, it was on basic fundamental safety requirements, such as cable calculations, fault loop impedances, the values that they were telling you in the books were wrong. Unfortunately, that also proliferated into things like the on-site guide, in that dodgy copies of the on-site guide were also being available. So yeah, the new versions that come out from the IET now are all going to be stamped with a hologram so that you can tell it's an authenticated copy.
What do you look for the hologram?
Just look for the hologram.
But that could be fake.
It could be fake, yes, until they figure out how they're going to stop people from cloning holograms. Yeah, but at least then it's the first step. Folks, thank you very much for your time. Thank you for being patient with me. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.